Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to today's webinar, The Benefits of Selontra Rodent Bait for Your Business, presented by BASF. I'm Brett Harbison, and I'm going to be your moderator this afternoon. So during the next hour, our speakers are going to provide an overview of the U.S. rodenticide market, and they're going to share their advice and some of their experience with Selontra Rodent Bait. A quick note to pass on before we introduce today's speakers, and that is, the views expressed in today's webinar are those of the speaker and not necessarily the PCT Media Group or our parent company, GIE Media. And the presentation made during this webinar does not constitute an endorsement of the vendor or speaker's views, products, or services. I'm happy to introduce our speakers for today. We are happy to have as our speakers BASF's Jeremy Davis and Zap Pest Control's Joshua Foster. A little bit about both speakers. So Jeremy joined BASF 5 years ago, and he's the senior sales specialist for professional and specialty solutions for Southern California and Hawaii. And before joining BASF, Jeremy spent 8 years with Bell Laboratories, where he was a senior technical representative managing the West Coast business. And prior to his career in the pest management industry, he worked in the lawn and landscape business for 5 years. And then Joshua Foster. So Joshua is the pest control manager of Zap Termite and Pest Control in Sacramento. And he came to the pest control industry following time spent in the water and wastewater treatment industry. And this background has been helpful to him in terms of identifying and following laws and regulations. And, you know, while Joshua came to the pest control industry in the intent of business and infrastructure management, he's really grown to love being in the trenches, and he's going to talk about some of those experiences when he's up. So, again, the format for our webinar is that Jeremy's going to begin with an overview of the rodent control market and kind of take a deep dive into the benefits of using Selontra. And then we'll hear from Josh and talk about how Zap Termite and Pest has transitioned to Selontra in preparation for the recently passed California rodenticide legislation. And then lastly, we'll have a Q&A session in which you'll have an opportunity to ask both Jeremy and Joshua your questions. And what we'll do for that is you can ask them throughout the presentations, and I will collect them, and then we'll sort of do a rapid fire Q&A at the end. You can ask your questions at the bottom of your screen. There's a Q&A interface. Just type your questions in there, and again, we'll collect those all and ask them at the end. And with that, I'm going to turn things over to Jeremy.
Thank you, Brad. I appreciate the introduction. And thank you to everyone who's attending our seminar today on the benefits of Selontra for your business. Also wanted to thank Joshua Foster from Zap Pest Control for joining us, and then also PCT for organizing this webinar. We're going to move through the benefits of Selontra to your business, but first we wanted to start out with some movement in California. That is one of the hot topics of our industry right now, and the banning of second generation anticoagulants through the California Assembly Bill 1788. So what I wanted to do is take a few moments, first three slides or so, and share with you what that means for pest management professionals in the state of California, and then also in the future, what the future outlook is potentially for other states picking up this same legislation. So as you can see here, the why this was put into effect, and this was from Los Angeles Times last year in the fall. And you can see at the bottom that non-target wildlife and animals are being poisoned by anticoagulants. Here they show a necropsy found that this particular cat had bled to death internally as a result of rat poisoning, and that 5 liters of unclotted blood were actually found in his abdomen. So that is the big reason and the big push for this legislation in California, which just passed here a few months ago in 2020. And I wanted to move on to the next slide here. And because we are going to be kind of short on time today, we can't review the entire bill, but here is a link that includes the bill text. You can also see the history, the bill analysis, and what today's law is. So this is the California legislation, senate.ca.gov. But since we are not going to be reading through all the text today, there was just a few points that I wanted to point out directly from the bill. So under California Assembly Bill number 1788, their main purpose and statement at the top of that is the California Ecosystems Protection Act of 2020 would additionally prohibit the use of any second generation anticoagulant rodenticide as defined in this state until the director of DPR certifies to the Secretary of State that, among other things, the use of second-generation anticoagulants does not affect non-target wildlife. And within that, their reasoning and their facts stated in Section 1, Subsection 5, is that scientific research and state studies have found rodenticides in over 75% of the animals that were tested. So secondary poisoning is the big concern with anticoagulants. And then also in Section 1, Subsection 6, it says, while all anticoagulant rodenticides have a harmful impact on non-target animals, second-generation anticoagulant rodenticides, or eschars, particularly dangerous to non-targets because their single dose has a half-life of more than 100 days in a rodent's liver, thus leading to a higher potential for a secondary poisoning. So I just wanted to kind of highlight a few text documents out of that particular bill so that everybody is aware as to why. When we move through the legislation history in the state of California, we can see that this goes all the way back to 2014 when the Wildlife Habitat Bill has been passed. And that was banning any anticoagulants, both first gens and second gens, from wildlife habitat areas. We move all the way up through 2019 and 2020, and you can see that I filled in that AB 1788 box completely green. And that is because both the Assembly and the Senate had passed the bill late this August. And then September 29th, it was actually chaptered with the Secretary of State after Governor Newsom's signature. What this bill now will do is prohibit the use of any second generation anticoagulant rodenticide by anyone in the state with minor exemptions for agricultural and California Department of Public Health. I did pull a few of the exemptions that I wanted to highlight as well from the bill. And in section two, subsections one and two, it says that this section does not apply to the use of second generation anticoagulant rodenticides in either of the following locations: A, a medical waste generator, or B, a facility registered annually and subject to inspection of the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act. And when we look at agricultural and public health, it also says this section does not apply to the use of second-generation anticoagulants for agricultural activities. And then it states the list. Within this list, it says a warehouse used to store food for human or animal consumption, an agricultural food production site, including but not limited to a slaughterhouse or cannery, a factory, brewery, or winery, an agricultural production site housing water storage, and an agricultural production site housing rights of way and other transportation infrastructure. So with this bill, those are going to be the exemptions, but for the most part in the structural pest control industry, we're gonna have to be looking at alternative methods. And that's where Selontra will come into play. So when we look at an overall rodent management strategy and those companies starting to think about changing up or rewriting their rodent programs in the state because of the anticoagulant use and being prepared, we may not just be needing to move from an anticoagulant to a non-anticoagulant, but we may want to redefine how we're doing our rodent management for our clients. So I thought this slide would be important to put up, that an inspection is almost the important, most important part of a rodent pest management program. So always keeping in mind that a thorough inspection is gonna give you an outline of that account. What control tools can we use? How are we going to implement sanitation, harborage reduction, and exclusion? And maybe as professionals, if we haven't done it in the past, we offer that exclusion to our customers. And then, of course, looking at potential non-targets. Okay, do we need to be doing trapping or maybe using non-toxic rodent blocks for monitoring or implementing non-anticoagulants as bait? Secondary poisoning risk. Let's assess where these clients are located. How many bait points and locations? So making sure that we have correct bait placements in accordance with the label where rodents are going to come into contact. And then also the rodent pressure and activity areas, making sure that whatever bait that we're using or whatever traps that we're deploying are checked regularly and we have enough bait to eliminate that colony or that population. And then very important, the communication with the account. Discussing with our clients, whether it be homeowners or business owners, multifamily housing, making sure that we're all on the same page, working together, especially when implementing more of these IPM methods to make sure that we have that good control. Remember, inspection is so important that if we don't understand the problem, how can we exactly deliver a complete solution? So when we move into the US rodenticide market, I've listed here 10 active ingredients used by manufacturers throughout the country, and I've grouped them into two categories. We have our anticoagulants on the left and our non-anticoagulants on the right. Anticoagulants are also broken down into two categories, first generation or second generation. We may also know them as multiple feed baits, such as first generation, or single feeding rodenticides under second generation. And the first generation anticoagulants had come out in the 50s and the 60s, which required multiple feedings by the rodents. So therefore, in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, the second generation anticoagulants were added to the market and used by professionals predominantly throughout the country today. They both thin out the blood, cause internal bleeding and hemorrhaging. So their mode of action is the same, but the difference between the first generation and the second generation is how much needs to be consumed and over how long of a time period. With that being said, the multi-feed should take multiple days to achieve a lethal dose. The second generations or single feeds, a rodent should be able to consume that lethal dose in one feeding or in one day. So you can see out of the 10 current active ingredients used by manufacturers in the US, seven of them belong to the anticoagulant category. When we look at alternatives that are not anticoagulants, we look at non-anticoagulants such as cholecalciferol, bromethalin, and zinc phosphide, which are all different modes of action. Selontra, which we'll be discussing today, uses the active ingredient cholecalciferol. Bromethalin is an ATP inhibitor in stopping the conversion of food into energy. And then zinc phosphide, though it is labeled for commensal rodents, house mice, Norway rats, roof rats, is primarily used more for field pests, such as gophers, ground squirrels, voles, prairie dogs, and so on. It is already a federally restricted use product. When we look at the California bill, we're looking at eliminating the second generation anticoagulant category and any of the rodenticides that have the following active ingredients: difenacoum, bromodiolone, berdifacoum, and difethiolone. One of the questions that a lot of times rodenticide manufacturers will get is how long until death? So we wanted to share this slide here where we can see cholecalciferol will actually lead to death within a 3 to 5 day time period after a lethal dose has been consumed. Some of our field trials have already shown that we have dead mice appearing within about 24 hours. You can also see that that lines up right with the second generation anticoagulants in about a 3 to 5 day time period. Your first generation anticoagulants, being those multiple feed baits, could take anywhere from 5 to 10 days. And if you are using a first generation anticoagulant, be sure to follow the label and keep an uninterrupted supply of bait because it's going to take that multiple feeding. Then when we look at bromethalin, which is another non-anticoagulant, we can see the response time is about 2 to 4 days. And then I did include zinc phosphide on this chart for reference. And zinc phosphide is going to kill within hours versus days. So this kind of gives a little overview as to the time to death once a lethal dose has been consumed by the rodent in all of these different categories. When we look at the active ingredient, cholcalciferol, in Selontra rodent bait, cholcalciferol is a prohormone requiring metabolic conversion. It is a vitamin D3 and a non-anticoagulant, and it's calcification of soft tissues with high doses. And you can see the activation in the liver and the kidney, and it causes hypercalcemia. So it's a buildup of calcium on the vital organs. The active ingredient, cholcalciferol, also demonstrates a stop feed action after ingesting a lethal dose. Death will occur within about 3 to 5 days. And because of that stop feed action, the rodents can no longer continue to consume an excess amount of bait. Therefore, it ensures the colony distribution. There is currently no known resistance to cholcalciferol, and it is highly unlikely because of the amount of active ingredient that needs to be consumed for a lethal dose, and because of that cease feeding effect, where once a rodent consumes that lethal dose, they are no longer able to feed. When we look at the product itself and the formulation, you'll note that it says soft block formulation. It could be considered a soft bait, but at the same time, it is a little bit more solid than that of the soft baits that are currently on the market. So I like to call it a soft block. So it is a little more solid. It's not oily and greasy. And it is contained in a 20-gram package or a polyfin film by BASF. The pail size is 8 pounds. It is only available in one particular size. It does not fall under the EPA mandate of second-generation anticoagulants being sold in 16-pound containers or greater. This particular product, along with the first-generation anticoagulants, the minimum saleable container is 4 pounds. So we've decided to go with an 8-pound rectangular pail. And in each pail, there is 182 packages of bait or sachets. It has a proven palatability and a patented polyfin film wrapper. This particular wrapper is different than the soft baits you may have seen or experienced out on the market that use a paper packaging. This particular packaging prevents the oil absorption and also has little laser drilled holes to help the aroma escape. You can see the photos on the right-hand side of your screen down up towards the bottom. And this is just a photo I took of the packages inside of a pail, and then a close-up of the package or sachet itself, where you can kind of make out the small little laser drilled holes. It does compete with the natural food sources, but it's also very important when doing any type of rodent baiting program that we try and eliminate as much competing food as possible. So that's where our clients come into effect as well, is to make those recommendations on putting the trash in the trash containers, cleaning up the bird seed, picking up the fallen fruit, and so on. We want the rodents to have to find the rodenticide and use that as their food source. These particular packages are securable in bait stations or on bait trays. And just this year in 2020, we made an enhancement and added a hole to the center of the package. Because it is more of a soft block formulation, for those of you throughout the country that are in cooler climates or freezing climates, though the product is stable between 0 degrees and 177 degrees, we thought it would be very important to put a hole in the center of that packaging so that when you're skewering through the rod and securing to a bait station, you will now just puncture through the packaging itself and not have to pierce through the bait. Each package contains 0.075% active ingredient cholcalciferol. And then the bait also contains Bitrix. You may notice on some of your rodenticide labels today that underneath the front section where it says active ingredient and inert ingredients, it may say contains Bitrix or contains denatonium benzoate. That is a bittering agent that is added by the manufacturer to help prevent accidental poisoning or consumption by children. When we look at the features and how Selontra can benefit your business, I've listed five here. Number one is the patented formulation. As we had just spoken about, the proven palatability and the polyfin film. We have some ongoing studies as well with the packaging and how it holds up against snails and slugs and other insect activity. And we're finding very favorable results. So the packaging really is going to be a win-win for this particular product. We also look at resistance management. So there has been colonies spread throughout the country that have already been found that are resistant to anticoagulant rodenticides. And not just the first generation anticoagulants, but there's also been studies that are showing that second generation anticoagulants are posing resistance to rodents. So a good rotation and maybe even moving on to a non-anticoagulant or switching out between modes of action is really going to help combat against that anticoagulant resistance, just as we deal with the cockroach control. Third is fast colony kill. So we have faster control with shorter baiting cycles. And a lot of that has to do with the stop feed action. And I'll show you a few examples in our field trials. The last two, I've highlighted out the green box on the outside, which are very, very important and probably the most important that I find, especially for our clients doing business in California with this particular new bill. The stop feed action gives less consumption and greater availability, meaning that a lot of times the dominants will eat more than their fair share. And what this is allowing is that the dominants get to enter the stations first. They consume their lethal dose and then it can no longer feed, ensuring distribution throughout the colony. And lastly, secondary poisoning. Low risk of secondary poisoning to both birds and mammals. So as compared to anticoagulants that pose the risk for secondary poisoning and the whole reason of AB 1788 in California, when compared to those non-anticoagulants, both colcalciferol in Selontra and bromethalin have not shown any secondary poisoning to date. We can't say that there's never going to be that particular chance, but it is listed as the lowest risk with these active ingredients when compared to anticoagulants. When we look at some field studies with Selontra rodent bait, and this one was done in North Carolina on a pig farm with house mice. What we did is we used pre-baiting and used the pig feed that was there. For 3 days, we wanted to see how many grams of this non-toxic bait or this pre-bait was consumed. We gave it a lag period and then introduced Selontra. And you can see on day one, over 100 grams was consumed. Day two, there was no feeding. And day three, there was little feeding. And if you move all the way over to the ends, you'll see that we added that pig feed in a post-baiting form to see how we were able to control that population. And after day seven and the introduction of that post-baiting, another 7 day lag period, we concluded that we had 100% control because there was no additional feeding. A second field study done in New Orleans, this was targeting roof rats. And here we used a pre-bait of a bulgur wheat formulation and found over 500 grams consumed in the first 3 days. Once we introduced Selontra rodent bait, you can see that we have almost received 600 grams consumed in just day one. And then the bait tapers off and the feeding goes down day two, day three, and a little spike in day five. We waited another 10 days and introduced as post-baiting and had no consumption. One of the things that I wanted to point out here on both of these slides is we should always be seeing more feeding on day one and day two and then tapering down. And that has to do with the stop feed action because those rodents can no longer consume more than their fair share of the bait, thus allowing that distribution throughout the colony. Rodenticide toxicology, I wanted to touch on in just a few slides before we wrap up, and that is primary poisoning and secondary poisoning. So here I have pulled the slide from the top 10 pet toxins in 2017 by the Animal Poison Control Center. You can see that rodenticides is on there as number 8, insecticides is number 7. But the main point that I want to make from this slide is that anything can be toxic. It's all going to be dose dependent, and that's why it's very important that moving forward, we're always having that good communication with our clients, making sure that they're keeping even their prescription medication and food and different plants picked up. At the end of the day, primary poisoning can be avoided if we think through with a plan. Maybe we implement snap traps or non-toxic blocks or bait to do monitoring. We put our bait stations outside of the fence line where the dog or the pet cannot gain access to it. And of course, keeping in mind that the label on most all of your rodenticides, including Selontra, says place up to 100 feet away from a man-made structure. So we can't consider the fence lines a man-made structure, but it's very important that if a dog only plays in the backyard and we have other places that we can implement our rodenticide and put some non-toxic bait stations, monitoring, snap traps in the back, then we're going to be able to help avoid primary poisoning altogether. And with that, I wanted to share a quick video from Dr. Natalie Young of the ASPCA, a lead veterinarian, and she is going to explain the difference with primary poisoning and treatment for anticoagulants versus cholecalciferol.
I'm Dr. Natalie Young. I'm the Vice President of the American College of Veterinary Pharmacists, and I'm the Director of Relay Veterinary Pharmacy. And due to my specialty, I'll be addressing with you rodenticide toxicity. It's something that is a very real concern for us in the veterinary world. ASPCA regularly lists rodenticides as one of the top 10 toxins encountered in the house. If you do encounter a case of accidental rodenticide toxicity with an animal, always consult your local veterinarian or call the ASPCA. In talking to you about the rodenticides, I'm going to focus on two. I'm going to focus on anticoagulants and cholecalciferol. And the patient that I'm going to use as my reference will be the canine patient. So dogs are naturalistic gorgers. They will eat anything and everything put in front of them, and everything is their favorite. And so that's why we usually don't see cases of toxicity like in my feline patients, because they're really picky. And so they're not going to get into toxins as much. Quickly looking at anticoagulants. So once you have the bait ingestion, it's not immediately that we start seeing the effects of the potential toxicity. So it can take within 1 to 7 days. So the clotting factors have to start shutting down, and then where the animal, the patient, loses the ability to form blood clots and can bleed to death. We do have an antidote available. If we do have a patient that gets into an anticoagulant, we use vitamin K1. But with that, vitamin K1 is not a magic bullet. It's not going to just cure the patient immediately. We sometimes have to give them once or twice daily vitamin K1 orally, and that can be for a week up to 6 weeks. It's prolonged therapy and supportive care. Sometimes they need fluids, sometimes they need blood transfusions, they need oxygen sometimes. It's dependent on a case-by-case basis. With cholecalciferol, we sometimes see the signs and symptoms of toxicity a bit quicker. We can see those within 12 to 36 hours. And what I'm mainly concerned about in those patients is not bleeding to death, but what I'm mainly worried about in those first 36 hours is renal failure. With the cholecalciferol, we don't have one specific antidote. We're going to use all kinds of medicines in our toolbox to provide supportive care for that patient. And again, this is a case-by-case basis. We may need to use a diuretic, and that way we're going to try to increase the urination so that maybe we can flush the toxin out of the system quicker. We may be using phosphate binders because we're worried about the amount of phosphorus in the bloodstream. We may be pulling on bisphosphonates to try to prevent accumulation of toxins into the muscles. We may be using antiemetics if we've got a lot of vomiting going on in that patient, or using GI protectants to try to protect the gut of that patient. In all of these cases, whether it be an anticoagulant or cholecalciferol, the most important thing is realizing that that accidental ingestion has occurred as quickly as possible, and then trying to induce vomiting. And we can do that sometimes with getting activated charcoal in the patient. We definitely need to get them to the hospital as soon as possible. When we're looking at therapy, I already mentioned with anticoagulants, we may be treating these patients up to 6 weeks. And it's the same thing with cholecalciferol. Again, this is going to be on a case-by-case basis. We may be treating the patient for a week. We may be treating them up to several weeks. It is dependent. And whether we've got anticoagulant, accidental poisoning, or cholecalciferol, we're going to be providing that patient with prolonged supportive care. I'm Dr. Nat.
So I think just to wrap that up with primary poisoning, the importance and the take-home message is let's prevent primary poisoning as much as possible. Implement IPM methods, okay? Speak with the customer. Keep that good communication open. Use tamper-resistant bait stations. Secure the bait stations. Make sure that they're labeled on the exterior in case there is any accidental poisoning. And then always make sure that the label would be available. All of your rodenticide labels have a note to physician section and a note to veterinarian section so that they know what was exposed. Also, a good time is checking the bait stations to make sure that we knew what we had inside that station. Okay, what particular bait, how many blocks or how many packages of bait did we put in there? And then how many were missing if we do have an accidental poisoning? And all of that information needs to be relayed to the veterinarian. As far as secondary poisoning goes, this was a slide that was pulled from Oregon State University. And we see there, third from the bottom, is that cholecalciferol has a low risk of secondary poisoning to birds and a low risk of secondary poisoning to mammals. And that is a direct effect of the AB 1788 legislation in California because of the concern of secondary poisonings with anticoagulants. So cholecalciferol, zinc phosphide, and bromethalin with those low risks of secondary poisoning are excluded from the AB 1788 bill. And lastly, before I turn it back over to Brad, is we have plenty of Selontra rodent bait supporting material available. Please look for contacting your local representative from BASF or your BASF authorized agent. Or you can look to pestcontrol.basf.us and find all of the information and collateral that we have for Selontra, including the sell sheet, FAQ for frequently asked questions and answers. We have a bait switch record or technical information bulletin. And then we also will provide station stickers for those of you that need to relabel bait stations when making the transition over into Selontra. And then, of course, the SDS and label can be downloaded as well. So with that, I want to thank you for your time today. I want to pass this back over to Brad at PCT for his interview with Joshua Foster. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Terrific presentation. And we did get some questions that came in for you. And again, we're going to kind of hold those to the end. So I know you're going to jump back on here. And to our participants, again, if you do want to ask those, type those into the Q&A box there at the bottom of your screen and try to get through as many of those as we can here towards the end of the webinar. All right. And so with that, we'll move on to the next part of our webinar and looking forward to hearing from Joshua Foster, PMP out of California. And again, he's the pest control manager of Zap Termite and Pest Control in Sacramento. And we wanted to, talk to Joshua a little bit about rodent control and his experiences with Selontra. And Joshua, just to start with, talk a little bit about the rodent business and how has that been affected by COVID-19? Do you feel, you're seeing an increase or a decrease in rodent pressure?
First of all, hello. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you guys today. The current state of rodents, I think everybody in the industry will tell you, has gone up significantly over the last few months. At least that's my observation. Maybe it's people staying home more, creating more of the food at home versus restaurants closing, but they are seeking other areas to feed, and it seems like residents are making the call. There's a major uptick in work for us since COVID.
And Jeremy kind of reviewed some of the issues going on with anticoagulant rodenticides in California. Talk about that a little bit. How has the anticoagulant rodenticide ban in California affected your business?
Well, I tell you what, we were very fortunate. We pay very close attention to the legislation here. We pay close attention to, even before the legislation, paying attention to the actives that are available. As you can see, he pointed out, there's only a handful of actives for rodents that are available, especially in California, with a lot of those going away now. But we were fortunate to be ahead of the curve. We were switching because legislation indicated that this day was coming. We made the switch ahead of time. And I would say the results that we've had, even if you weren't, maybe there's people in other states now that are tuned in today. I think even from a apples to apples standpoint, it's been very the switch has been very beneficial. Not even due to the legislation, and I don't think it had any impact really on us. But I do think you're going to see a big turn in how they're addressing these things, and I think the industry will see that. This active is much superior to what we were dealing with before.
And talk a little bit about the Selontra rodent bait. Which one of the benefits or a couple of the benefits have you found to be most useful? For example, the stop feed action controls the population a lot faster.
Stop feed, I do find that to be important, and we are noticing it based on volume on commercial accounts right now. And based on the hits that we're getting each time that we're going back, whether it's weekly or whether it's every 3 days, the hits that we're getting in the areas that we're monitoring, we're noticing a lot on the first day placement of bait and then just kind of a disappearance. When we go back in 3 days or a week. Very well done. The other benefits, really, just the pail, I thought was greatly beneficial for somebody that's trying to go in and out and keep the bait secure while you're doing your work. Whereas with a bigger, a 5 gallon container, you're required to make a transition to another secure container or your rodent bag or something, which opens you to vulnerabilities, I feel like, to any dogs or cats or whatever that might be around. I did find that to be beneficial. I noticed there was a little bit of dialogue in the industry about, well, you know, I only get this much versus a pail of some kind of block with bromodiolone. And I don't even really think that's close because you're using so much less of it. Even he was pointing out, even the dominants will stop eating. Whereas if they're allowed to continue to eat, while there's another active in there, they're just tearing up your bait, but really they're already dying. And I think that's where the cutoff is really creating a benefit to using the lower amount.
All right. Appreciate you sharing some of those experiences for our participant, Joshua. And right now, as I mentioned, we're gonna jump into the Q&A here. We did receive some questions. And so Joshua and Jeremy, if you both wanna stay on here. And again, folks who are participating, we'll continue to field those questions throughout. If you wanna just type those into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And like I said, we'll get to as many of those as we can. Jeremy, the first question is for you, and it just wanted a little more information about the Bitrix. Why doesn't that interfere with the product?
Of course. Thanks, Brad. So Bitrix and both a bittering agent and then also a dye were required by the EPA back in the 80s and the 90s so that, number one, a dye could show up in either the stool or a vomit of a non-target that had actually consumed the bait, so that we would have an idea if there was an actual poisoning or not. And then Bitrix as well. Bitrix isn't in all of the rodenticides, but most all of the rodenticides on the U.S. market today. That and also denatonium benzoate being those bittering agents. So some of the previous articles that I had read was that because this was a necessary ingredient or inert ingredient to be added in the protection and safety for children, is that then manufacturers kind of had to go back to the table and say, okay, what types of raw materials or inert ingredients can we add that will help mask the flavor of the bittering agent for the rodents, but at the same time, deter children from actually consuming the bait? So it's a great question. With Bitrix, rodents taste is going to be very particular, and even the different active ingredients themselves. Cholecalciferol tastes different than bromodiolone. All of that is dependent on the inert ingredients and the formulation that's put together from the manufacturer to help deter children, but at the same time be accepted by rodents.
The next question, it probably aimed more towards you, Jeremy, but Joshua, if you have any experience, if you want to jump in, please do. And that was, again, can you explain how the stop feed option works?
Oh, absolutely. Another great question. So with the active ingredient cholecalciferol and bromethylene, so those two non-anticoagulants actually force the rodent to cease feeding after a lethal dose has been consumed. It's going to be different with anticoagulants because they do not have a stop feed action. Therefore, if they've consumed a lethal dose, those dominants may return day after day until death finally occurs and consume more. So then what do we have? We have almost a super toxic rodent, if you will. And that was one of the big issues with secondary poisoning and second generation anticoagulants. When we look at cholecalciferol and bromethylene, it's how the active ingredient actually affects the mammal after ingesting a lethal dose. It's nothing that can be added by a manufacturer to make them cease feeding. And it's how the active ingredient works on that body once that lethal dose has been achieved. So those are the two particular active ingredients that have that stop feeding effect. And the big benefit that we find, and I can probably have Josh jump in here too and add, is that if you look at rodenticide labels on your anticoagulant baits, you could see anywhere from 3 to 16 blocks or 10 to 48 soft baits per bait station. And if you look at the Selontra label, which we didn't have time to get into today, 2 to 8 packages is the label rate for rats, and 1 to 2 packages is the label rate for mice. And that just goes to show that to control a colony because of that stop feed where each individual rat receives only their lethal dose, that bait's going to last a heck of a lot longer.
Josh, was there anything you wanted to add, or you want me to jump into the next?
No, you know what? I did want to say that I can validate what he's saying in the field. And there's even some cases where the guys are starting to remember when they go back to that station, not even checking their device or their data, but just remembering, man, I put four in here, where with other blocks, you're kind of just refilling it because most of the time it's been emptied out. So guys are paying closer attention because you've lowered the number that you got to keep track of, and it's still very effective.
Next question was sort of a follow-up with the stop feed. Was the stop feed mechanism, again, the stop feed mechanism that you spoke of, what are the chances the rodent may stop feed before a lethal dose? My understanding is this stop feed comes from the bad taste of the bait. Is that correct?
So we haven't had in any of our trials, we haven't had any rodents cease feeding before they've achieved a lethal dose. On average, when we're looking at house mice, and all of the studies aren't, the repetitions aren't completed and published yet, but when we're looking at house mice, it was about 2 grams on average that was needed for a lethal dose. Roof rats, I believe it was around 10 grams, and then Norway rats around 13 grams. And these are 20 gram packages. So ideally, if you have an empty package and you're dealing with mice, you probably killed 10 mice out of one package. And I think the important thing that we remember too is that it's not necessarily that a rodent won't eat the bait because of the formulation. It may just be because of the active ingredient. And it's the manufacturer's job to come up with a formulation that's going to mask that active ingredient so that the rodent will actually consume a lethal dose. And then, of course, just like we had mentioned at the beginning as part of our IPM methods, is sanitation, harborage reduction, exclusion. You know, sanitation is a big one, making sure that there aren't competing food sources. And that just goes with any type of rodenticide that you want a rodent to consume.
Sorry. A question was, is there a risk of the protective coating coming off of the bait and leaving a bait station as there is with other baits, soft baits?
So another good question, and I'll have Josh maybe jump in after this comment. I've had the pleasure of working with this rodenticide since it was launched in the U.S. and registered with the EPA in 2017. To date, I have yet to see a package or a sachet removed from a bait station. What we found with a lot of clients as well is that the rodent has consumed the inside of the package or consumed the bait itself, and then they weren't interested in the package. Now, what we've seen in the past with other soft baits that maybe use a paper packaging is that some of those soft baits have been removed from the station. This is only my theory, but because the paper packaging absorbs oils and greases, I have a feeling that a lot of that bait formulation sticks to the package, and that's why the rodents may be interested in it. With this polyfin film, we don't have any absorption, and therefore the bait's not adhering to the package itself. So as I mentioned, I have not seen them removed because the rodent is just interested in what's inside the package. But of course, we can't say that it will never happen.
The next question was, why is there little risk for secondary poisoning?
So another good question with the secondary poisoning, and the reason that the non-anticoagulants were not included in the California legislation. The low risk of secondary poisoning comes from a few different things. Number one, because of that stop feed action, a rodent is only able to consume that lethal dose. And unlike anticoagulants, or especially second generation anticoagulants, that they may achieve a lethal dose today, but they could also go back and feed for the next 3 to 5 days until death. With colcalciferol and the stop feed action, they can no longer feed. They cannot consume more and become super toxic or get an overdose, if you will. And then the other point is, and it actually was listed in the bill under second generation anticoagulants, that on average, the half-life where the active ingredients remaining in the blood, the muscle, and the tissue of that deceased rodent could be greater than 100 days. I think with active ingredients like difenacoum, for example, berdifacoum, it could be over 200 days that the half-life remains. With colcalciferol, it is biodegraded about 10 times faster, and the half-life on our study shows only about 20 days. So those are some of the main reasons that we haven't seen the secondary poisoning concerns.
A question was, what is the lifespan of the bait in a bait station under normal circumstances?
So, you know, that one's tough, I think, for any rodenticide. And that's just because, you know, we're talking about rodenticides being made up of primarily food grade materials, right? So the fresher, the better. And especially when we're putting it up against, say, at the back of a fast food restaurant where there's cheeseburgers and French fries that are thrown out every evening into the dumpsters. So we say that, you know, the shelf life, I guess, if you want to put a number on it, is that the bait should be good for at least a year in normal conditions. Now, maybe it's longer. What I can say from experience, though, is I still have some rodenticide from 2017 and 2018 from some of the first Selontra batches, which I currently use, and it's still being accepted today, and that was over 3 years ago.
Question was, is it only in soft bait form? And if so, are you concerned about rodents dragging out the packets? Comment was, even if they eat the bait, they may leave an empty packet, leaving us to wonder if a rodent or a pet ate it.
Yeah, so I think that, I think number one, we had addressed the one question with the removal of the bait. But one thing, and I'm kind of glad it got brought back up, is one thing I wanted to add is with that enhancement that we made in 2020 and added that hole into the center of the Selontra, we're finding too that that is directly in the center where hopefully we're not accidentally just skewering a bait maybe on the corner where it would have less mass and it would be easier to be ripped off. Hopefully we're skewering that in the middle every single time. So it should be less likely that they're removed, but at the same time, it's not to say that it could never happen. So I think the important thing is making sure that we're following the label, making sure that we're skewering right in the center where that center hole is, and always making sure that we're keeping an eye on our accounts, right? If we do see any packages or anything like that that are out and about, just like we want to make sure our stations are secure, we want to make sure that they're properly labeled and latched when we leave, making sure that we're picking up dead rats and mice as they appear. So I think that's the big thing, is making sure that everything gets secured properly. And because the Selontra doesn't have that oil uptake or that absorption, I have a feeling that we'll see a difference between that and the soft baits that are using the paper packaging, as far as does it get absorbed and does it get ripped out.
Jeremy, the question was, does Selontra stay looking fresh or does it turn black like other baits do?
So that would also be throughout the different climates or different environment that we're in. It is food grade material. So let's think of moist weather, right? If it's soaking in water, any types of food grade material, a lot of different baits, especially your soft baits that are made more with oils versus paraffin or wax, they could mold. They could turn black, they could turn gray, they could turn white. I think the important thing too that we want to remember, and kind of just like the previous question, is make sure that we have a fresh, uninterrupted supply of bait. So I know some clients around the country always switch out for new bait every single time that they go and do a service, whether it be monthly or quarterly or bi-monthly. Some leave it. And quite honestly, what I do at my house is I leave the bait. If it's only a half full package and it's still being accepted, I'll just add a few fresh baits. So yes, the color may change. That's also another thing that we found out from our technical team is that clients had been reporting seeing maybe some different colors, like a white or a grayish color with the bait. And that is actually the sugars that may be pulling to the surface in different climates and different weather conditions. So it was almost described to me as a Hershey's chocolate bar that was left out. And once it comes in contact with the air, it turns a little bit white or gray. But with my experience, those baits were accepted almost just as well as the fresh bait that I would put out that day.
Joshua, a question for you. Can you give us an example of a high rodent pressure account that you service and how Selontra has worked in this type of accounts?
Sure. I'm going to tell you right off the bat, storage facilities, where you have maybe 100 bait stations or in excess of 100 bait stations, and you're going through, you're checking them all, and to go on to cut through the middle or to go to the other side, maybe you're carrying an excessive amount of a different block. But Selontra, what I've noticed is guys aren't having to change out every box. They're able to leave bait effectively in areas. And even where it's been beneficial as well is where you couldn't effectively target around dumpsters or anything that was a competing source that was within 5 or 10 feet of your station. We've noticed that Selontra will attract from those areas. I'm not saying put it on top of your dumpster, obviously, but it is very competitive in environments that have multiple sources. But just being able to quickly identify what you're dealing with in a high volume account versus you don't get that indication from maybe some of the other blocks. You just know that there was activity, where with these, I think you get more of an indication of how many, like he was saying, how many potential rats that you may have defeated in that battle.
A question was, how specifically does it work to kill rodents? Is it an attack on the nervous system for them to stop feeding?
Yeah, so it's a, it's actually a, it's a calcium mobilizer. So it's moving the calcium through the bloodstream and then attaching itself through the process of hypercalcemia. And it's attaching the excess calcium to the vital organs, which is, calcium shouldn't be built up on the vital organs. So if you guys want to look that up, there's a bunch of different papers on cholecalciferol itself. As I had said, there's a vitamin D3, which is made from cholecalciferol, that you'll be even able to find at a Walmart or a Walgreens, CVS. Vitamin D3 is a naturally occurring substance, and that we're getting most of the vitamin D3 that we need on a daily basis because of our jobs and because of being out in the sun. But you'll see the vitamin D3 in multivitamins. You'll see it right beside the vitamin C or vitamin E on the shelf at the pharmacy. And the important thing that to remember is that a lot of things, like a vitamin or like warfarin, even for example, may be good for the body. Certain ones of us take these medications and these supplements. But once again, when it comes to rodenticide poisoning and it comes to poisoning in general, it's all going to be dose dependent, right? Some things may be good for the body, but in large doses, very toxic to the body. But check out cholecalciferol, and you can get as technical as you want as to exactly how that active ingredient works.
I think you might have just actually kind of covered that with the cholecalciferol conversation, but the question was, he was told that there was no antidote for cholecalciferin in primary feeding. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes. And actually, we we did see that with the discussion with Dr. Natalie Young on the video that was played, where anticoagulants do have an antidote. It is vitamin K1, but then she goes to explain that it may take even more than just that, and that vitamin K1 is not necessarily a silver bullet. With cholecalciferol, there is no one specific antidote. And the same thing with bromethalin. So when you look at the non-anticoagulants, vitamin K1 is not going to do anything in reversing the effects. But there are a lot of treatment options, and there are guidelines listed on the label under note to physician and note to veterinarian as to how they can help reverse these effects.
A question was for Jeremy, when you leave the bait out at your home, how long have you left it? And has it still been acceptable?
So I don't use me as an example, because I probably should be checking my bait stations more often. I have left bait out at my house for 3-month period, for 6-month period. Especially this year, I haven't been checking it too much. And yes, it has still been accepted. Like I said, I even pulled out bait from a 2017 pail and introduced that into the bait station, and I had feeding on that. But at the same time, leaving it out in the environment, you know, I live in Southern California, so we're not getting as much rain. I don't get the cold weather or the high moisture content. And those are all going to be dependent, right, on where we're located throughout the country, is what type of climate are we dealing with, and how often should we be changing out our bait. But I haven't really removed any bait that's left, only empty packages.
A question we had here is rotation recommended?
So another great question on rotation, right? I think one of the issues, right, that we ran into with anticoagulant rodenticides, first generation, second generations, all the different active ingredients, very similar to pyrethroids, right? And the problems that we're having into with resistance on cockroaches. One of the reasons too that we're switching and talking about using multiple different active ingredients, so is not just because of this bill, but very much like Josh said, you know, hey, he found a lot of different benefits that really didn't even have to do anything with the bill, but put them and their company ahead of the game. I think when we're rotating out different active ingredients with different modes of action, we're going to help prevent the buildup and the pass of that gene pool to a resistance trait. Second generation anticoagulants, a lot of time you'll even see those on the label. This says targets against anticoagulant resistance. But yet then we finally found that there's been some resistance in those different active ingredients as well. With cholecalciferol and bromethalin, buildup of resistance is not likely. And that all has to do too, because of that stop feed action, because they're not overdoing it and they're not consuming and build up that resistant from one generation to the next. So when you're looking at your non-anticoagulants, you shouldn't have any resistant issues. But at the same time, I would recommend doing some rotation, and it may not just be one bait to the next. It may be a monitoring bait. And then when we get hits, we implement Selontra or we implement a toxic bait. Because at the end of the day, that's going to help keep additional pesticide out of the environment. And we'll always have less chance of a primary poisoning or even a secondary poisoning if we're using our monitoring baits and implementing those good IPM measures.
All right. I'm just checking it over. Looks like that's all we have as far as Q&A. And actually, we're right at an hour. So that worked out well. But if folks didn't get their questions answered, I'm sure you can follow up with Jeremy and Joshua. I don't know if you want to pass along your contact info. One question we did have that I'll answer here. A couple folks had wanted to see it, had asked about a recording. We are recording the webinar. So once we get it edited and web optimized, we'll upload it to our website. And we'll also provide a copy to the folks at BASF. So you can contact your rep and get it from them as well. So with that, I want to thank everybody for participating and asking a lot of great questions, made for a great interactive webinar. And I'm going to just kind of turn things back over to Jeremy and Joshua and see if they want to make any kind of closing remarks.
Well, I will jump in first. I will say, thank you, Joshua. Thank you, Zap Pest Control. We really appreciate your support and being with us today to explain how Selontra has really benefited your company. Secondly, I'd like to say thanks to PCT for putting on this webinar and hosting. What a great time with attendees all across the country. And then also to all of the attendees, thank you. On behalf of BASF and our reps spread throughout the country, thank you for all your business and all your great partnership and support over the years. So with that, Josh, I will turn it back over to you if you have any last words, but thank you all for attending today.
Yeah, thank Jeremy. The first thing I'm going to tell you is, man, that is a beautiful office you have there. very impressive. Really, I just want to say thank you. I'm kind of just the sidekick here, man. You did a great job, but there's even some explanations in there that was new data for myself. Great job. Thank you, PCT. Thank you, BASF. Thank you, Matthew and the owner here at Zap for allowing me to have this opportunity to work with you guys.
All right. Thanks again, everybody, for attending, and have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.